Welcome to In the Zone. This week we'll be getting to the latest in NFL free agency and, of course, March Madness, right here on In the Zone.
And Manning's going to heave one. Is
on its way. It bounces off the crossbar, and it's good!
NFL free agency has gotten off to an incredible start, but what really kicked off NFL free agency was Tom Brady coming out of retirement after only 40 days. MLB lockout lasted longer than that. Xavier, what was your reaction to this?
You know, I was actually kind of surprised. I generally thought that he was retired, but then it doesn't surprise me. You know, earlier that weekend, he went to a Manchester United game and saw Cristiano Ronaldo score a hat trick, and I think that like motivated him because Ronaldo is 37 years old, which is pretty old for a soccer player to still do that. And I think that, you know, from one goat to another, that kind of sparked him to like think about, you know, I think he was tired of hanging with his kids at home too long. I don't think he was having fun being a dad anymore. So now more of the question is, how does this affect the Buccaneers?
Well, I think this gives more motivation to guys like Gronk and other guys that are maybe going to go elsewhere in free agency. I think it gives them more motivation to come back to Tampa Bay. Bruce Arians, there were some rumors that maybe he would retire, not this year, but maybe next year. I think this gives more motivation, again, to everybody to come back and try to have Brady be sent out the right way, the way that he wants to. I think he's really wanting this farewell tour like Coach K and college basketball. So, but I think Brady, you know, the comeback, we all know what he's capable of. We all saw what he did in his first year with Tampa Bay. But again, I think you'll see possibly guys like Gronk come back and other guys that may have been free agency or may have tested free agency come back to Tampa.
Do you think that he has one more Super Bowl in him, though?
With Tom Brady, you never know. You know, if you surround him with the right guys, anything is possible. Right, Chris Godwin, I believe, got franchise tagged. Mike Evans, as we mentioned, Gronk might come back. I think running back is going to be where they have to get things figured out. Sure, they have Leonard Fournette, but if he gets hurt, we saw what happened. He got hurt. A few other guys got hurt. That's where the issue is. Also, defense, I think, is going to have to be a little bit better. They have talent on defense, but playing those big opponents, it's going to be tough. But I do like their chances with Seattle getting rid of Russell Wilson. The Saints, we don't really know what's going to happen with Jameis Winston. That division right now is in shambles.
I think that they still would be beneficial in picking up another receiver, especially the slot, because after they got rid of AB, you see how that actually did affect the team. Me personally, you know who I would like to see that would be a good addition to the team? Jarvis Landry.
Yeah,
he's going to get picked up because he's a very talented receiver. But if you could get him with Mike Evans and Chris Godwin along with Gronk already there, that's a Super Bowl team winning offense, at least for that part of the field.
Yeah, that was a good point about Antonio Brown. I think I tried to erase him from my memory after what he did. But yeah, I think if they get a few more talented pieces, they can do it. I mean, they already did it once. They can probably do it again. Another big move, the Pittsburgh Steelers signed Mitchell Trubisky to a two-year, $14 million deal. Meanwhile, in Cleveland, the Browns released Jarvis Landry after unsuccessfully restructuring his contract. Xavier, is Trubisky going to work out in Pittsburgh?
I mean, I think that he'll do better than Ben Roethlisberger ever could do right now because, like, he can actually be mobile now. Obviously, you could tell he's not there to stay for a long period of time. They're going to look. He's definitely like a reserve quarterback. They're looking for somebody permanent. But right now, he's a good option for like a year or two to stay. But, I mean, he's younger. He's more mobile. I wouldn't say he's necessarily a better thrower. But he definitely is more mobile. And right now, with the offensive line they have, they're going to need a little bit more of a mobile quarterback that can throw the ball so that he doesn't get injured like Ben did.
I think the answer to is Trubisky, the answer is in his contract, 2 years, right?
Yeah.
They probably looked at free agency, probably didn't like their chances there. They looked at the trade market, figured if we give up some talent, that's probably we're giving up more than what we would get. And then they probably looked at the draft and said, I don't like what I'm seeing there. So they said, let's get some guy that's decent for a couple of years and see where we are then.
The problem is that they couldn't get Deshaun Watson. And that's where I really thought. I was looking forward for Mike Tomlin and Deshaun Watson, because that would have been a scary lineup right there.
I think the problem with Deshaun Watson is, I'm sure we'll get to this later, is that the Texans are asking for too much. And as I said, if Pittsburgh gives up anything, they're probably giving up much more than what they get. And if they get Deshaun Watson, who knows if they do anything anyway.
Yeah. Carson Wentz is back in the NFC East after failing to lead the Colts to the playoffs. Indianapolis shipped him off to Washington. Michael, how do you see Wentz working out in Washington? And where do the Colts turn for the next quarterback?
Well, I think this is a nightmare scenario for Carson Wentz in Washington. Because take a look at FedEx Field. I mean, that is one of the just worst stadiums in the NFL. And it's not even that old. I mean, we saw last year the stands, the fence collapsed on Jalen Hurts and all the fans came out. We've seen countless quarterbacks get injured on that field. And with Carson Wentz being injury prone, who knows? I mean, that could be a nightmare scenario. And I wouldn't be surprised if we see Taylor Heineke taken back over after a few weeks.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, like you said, that field has been known for injury prone. I mean, RG3 got hurt there on the Patriots, even though that's a long time ago. You just look at that field and you see how it just looks so old. The grass looks ripped up all the time. And I mean, like, Carson Wentz couldn't be a leader in Indy. Do you think that he can be a leader for the Commanders?
Absolutely not. I mean, all they had to do was what? Beat the Jaguars in the last week of the season to get into the playoffs, and they couldn't even do that. And I just think that Wentz's leadership has been questioned ever since he was in Philly. I continued in Indianapolis, and I don't know, I just don't see that changing right now. I mean, it hasn't changed for a few years. I don't see that changing now. What I am looking forward to is the Commanders-Eagles game in Philly. Yeah. Philly fans are going to go nuts when he comes back.
Do you think that, I mean, I'm an Eagles fan, but do you think that Carson Wentz deserves to get booed, is my question.
I don't know if he deserves it, but I think he will. I know he will be.
I think that he doesn't deserve to get booed because he didn't really do anything wrong for leaving. I think of more of his reactions. I remember he definitely wasn't too happy and felt like he deserved to still be starting, so that might come off as the wrong way to the Eagles fans. But I mean, I think it's more of like we're booing him for not getting the fully the job. I mean, even though it wasn't his fault, I won't feel like he shouldn't get booed, but it's just going to always be like what could have been with him, because Nick Foles took us the rest of the way.
Yeah. And with Philly fans, just because a guy shouldn't deserve to get booed doesn't mean he won't.
Yeah.
But I feel like this is such a classic move for Washington, right? Yeah. I mean, they can't do anything right.
They couldn't get Garoppolo either.
They couldn't get Garoppolo. They couldn't get Russell Wilson. They even asked to talk to Wilson. And I'm pretty sure he declined. He like said, I don't want to talk to Washington.
Yeah, they couldn't get Jameis Winston either.
And so they went with Carson Wentz. I'm not seeing it.
Do you see them potentially getting anyone good in the draft, though?
I mean, before they got Carson Wentz, potentially, but now I don't think they will. I don't think they're going to try to. Over in the AFC West, the Broncos and Chargers have had a busy start to the NFL offseason. In Denver, the Broncos traded for Russell Wilson, giving up Noah Fant and quite a few draft picks, and as well as Drew Lock. Meanwhile, the Chargers have been building an absolute monster on defense, acquiring Khalil Mack, J.C. Jackson, and others. Xavier, what are your thoughts on these moves?
I feel like it was a very interesting move for the Denver Broncos. Now, I don't know that team very well when it comes to their weapons, but I do know that Russell Wilson is a very dangerous quarterback. And he's that good where he can make any team very well. He has, especially now throwing to Jerry Jeudy, in my opinion, one of the best route runners in the league. They'll have some problems, definitely. And I know that the Broncos have a very complete defense. And the Chargers, man, that defense is looking scary with Khalil Mack. Now they have Derwin James, J.C. Jackson, and Asante Samuel Jr., along with Bosa. It's going to look like a very dangerous defense for the Chargers. And I feel like they needed an upgrade on defense because they've always had a lot of talented defense, but they're off. There are some holes. They always had the, if you could add this player, if you could fill in another linebacker. Mm-hmm. Now that defensive line is looking like a problem. The defensive backs were always pretty good, but I feel like they didn't have a lot of good edge rushers, and now adding Khalil Mack is, everyone's going to be scared of him, obviously. Besides Aaron Donald, that's probably one of the scariest defensive linemen in the league.
My thing with the Broncos is, sure, Russell Wilson, there have been questions on him whether he has some left in the tank. I think he does. Their issue is going to be whether or not they re-sign Melvin Gordon, because if they get a good running back, then they're set for sure on offense. They probably already are anyway. As you said, their defense is very solid. My only question is, how will all this go with a brand new coach in Nathaniel Hackett? That's what I'm most interested to see. I don't really know what to think or say, because Nathaniel Hackett has, you know, he was working with Aaron Rodgers, right? Going from that to Russell Wilson. Obviously, he knows how to work with a really good quarterback, but in a whole new system.
Whole new system, and for Russell Wilson, it's a whole new system.
For both sides, yeah.
Pete Carroll your whole career, so, you know, both of them getting used to each other and both of them getting new to the system. Are they going to keep the old system, or is he going to have his own system?
Yeah, that's going to be the most interesting thing for me. So we'll see what happens in Denver, and as you mentioned, the Chargers defense is going to be crazy as well. In other NFL news, it was reported that Deshaun Watson will not face criminal charges from his sexual misconduct allegations 2 years ago. With this news, NFL teams across the league are chomping at the bit to get him. Xavier, what do you think is going to get Deshaun Watson?
I think that it's going to, my opinion, I think it's either going to be the Panthers or the Falcons. The Panthers, in my opinion, are pressing the hardest to get him, and they're willing to give up a lot. I wouldn't even be surprised if they traded Christian McCaffrey and multiple other players to get him. The problem that I think that is unfair for a lot of these teams, and I think this is a really good point that I would like to make, is that I feel like, obviously, Deshaun Watson is still going to face some, like, suspension or whatever for what he did.
I would hope so.
And I feel like they should have, the league should have announced what they're going to do with him before they let him back in the league for teams to scout him and, like, give him offers. Because if they, let's say they said, oh, we're going to suspend him for 6 games, who's to say all these teams would be at him right now? Because you're getting a player, but you don't know when you're going to be able to use him. So I feel like when players get in trouble for certain things, for allegations or suspensions or whatever, that the NFL needs to start telling teams what they're going to do with the player before they say, oh, you can let him back in the league, you can go and scout him or recruit him, that they need to do that first.
Yeah, there's a real interesting thing going on with the Browns right now. Before I get to that, as you mentioned, hopefully Deshaun Watson will get suspended. I mean, Calvin Ridley bets $1,500 on games, gets suspended for a whole year. Deshaun Watson has 22 sexual misconduct allegations against him, and the NFL says absolutely nothing.
Yeah.
I just don't know what message that's sending to NFL fans
in general. I don't think they
said
nothing. It's more that
they didn't do anything, I should say.
They haven't took any actions to what they will do with Deshaun Watson yet. They're like waiting for a team to pick him up first, where I feel like they need to set his punishment and then be like, okay, now he can come back in the league. Who wants Deshaun Watson now?
And in Cleveland, Baker Mayfield had this letter that left me scratching my head, where he was basically thanking Cleveland for everything and, you know, how great it was. And it made me think, did the Browns either tell him that they're done? Is Baker Mayfield done with the Browns? Or are they going to trade for Deshaun Watson? I'm curious as to what that's about.
I think Baker Mayfield just knows that
his time's coming.
And that whether he stays in that, he's at the point where he's very humbled now. You know, he's very arrogant and very cocky, and now he knows where he stands and how teams look at him, how his own team looks at him, where it's almost like he'll be lucky if he stays, and if he goes, he'll be lucky if a team picks him up. And he'll be lucky if he starts, especially. Because last year, especially, the worst thing that happened for him was that when Odell left, that he won a title. And then it looked like it's not Odell, it was Baker.
Mm-hmm. For sure. And I think there's a lot of teams that are obviously interested in Deshaun Watson. But the other thing to think about is he hasn't played for a year. How will that play into things as well?
Yes. On the other side of this break, we'll be getting into March Madness. Don't go anywhere. In the Zone, we'll be right back.
Basketball fans, it's that time of year once again. March Madness is here. The bubble is always closely watched in the months leading up to Selection Sunday. This year, Notre Dame, Rutgers, Wyoming, and Indiana were the last four teams in, and Dayton, SMU, Oklahoma, and Texas A&M were the first four teams out. So, Xavier, which teams do you think should have gotten in, and which teams got in that didn't deserve it?
I feel like every team who made it deserves to be in it. I feel like, you know, teams that got upset, it just happens. You know, sometimes, like, there's always a lot of good teams that don't make it in, but they just have, like, bad seasons. I feel like this is going to be an exciting year, especially. I'm excited for a lot of the top teams to see how far they can go and see what upsets are going to happen.
Yeah, I agree. I don't look at this field of 68 and see any team that shouldn't have got in. My questioning is on the seeding. You know, Auburn was a 2 seed, and sure, they had a rough end of the season, but I felt like they were more deserving of a 1 seed over Baylor. I felt like Baylor's collapse to the end of the season was worse than Auburn's. Also, Iowa getting a 5 seed after winning the Big Ten and having one of the hottest ends to the season ever. I mean, they scored like 100 points almost every game, it seemed. They were one of the more prolific scoring teams in all of college basketball, and they get a 5 seed? I didn't get that.
I think it's probably to do with competition that you play.
Yeah, I mean, they won the Big Ten, though.
They won the Big Ten, but how big competitive is the Big Ten compared to others?
Big Ten had the most teams in the tournament with 9.
Well, I don't know. I don't know. I feel like, I mean,
I don't know if that means it's competitive or not, but I don't know. I feel like Iowa was more deserving of a higher seed than 5. I'm not sure what you thought.
I mean, I feel like you said, if they won, I feel like they deserve to be number 1. I probably wouldn't put it 5-2. Maybe a 2, but not definitely 5. That's definitely way too high if you're going to win a tournament too.
Yeah, I could see bare minimum of 4. I was really confused about that one. Michigan and Iowa State getting in as first round bids and not having to play a play-in game was kind of surprising to me. Iowa State, one of the lower scoring teams in the whole country, and Michigan with their issues with the end of the season with Juwan Howard being suspended, and they didn't have the end of the season that they would have liked. But Indiana had to play a play-in game, and Indiana won a few games in the Big Ten tournament. They knocked off top seed in the Big Ten, Illinois. And Michigan lost their only game in the tournament. So I just wasn't sure how Michigan got in. And you even look at their record, and Indiana had a much better record than Michigan. That was a little confusing to me. What were your thoughts on that?
No, I just agree about your main point about how Iowa, if they won the Big Ten, that they should be number 1, especially with Michigan being higher than them, too.
Yeah, yeah. And, you know, Michigan was 17-14. They get an 11 seed first-round bid. Indiana, 20-13. They had to play a play-in game. I didn't get it. Mm-hmm. But now let's get into our final 4 picks and national championship picks. Xavier, what teams do you see making a run to New Orleans this year?
Teams that I see Gonzaga making all the way. In my opinion, I see Arizona making it far, and I see Kentucky making it far. I always leave one team number the 4 spot out because it's always going to be an upset. I'm not really sure I want to pick yet, but I definitely see those 3 teams making it.
Yeah, I think Gonzaga and Arizona are for sure the favorites there. I look at the East bracket, and I like Kentucky or UCLA. I don't think Baylor has what it takes to navigate their way through that bracket. I could see them losing to North Carolina or UCLA. Purdue has some possibility. I'm not crazy about them, but I do agree with you. I think Kentucky has a good chance with in the East bracket to get to the Final Four.
I could see North Carolina beating Baylor.
Sure.
It's playoffs time. There's never a perfect. Someone always upsets, or someone always who didn't necessarily play well and during regular season plays better in the tournament. So you never know. But at the same time, Baylor, did anyone think they were going to win last year?
No. I mean, a few people, but not as many.
Did anyone think that they were going to beat Gonzaga to the point where Gonzaga never had a lead on them in the entire game?
Yeah, Gonzaga was a heavy favorite last year.
Exactly. So, you know, I think Gonzaga's going to win, but they've shown, like, the question is this Gonzaga better than last year's Gonzaga?
Yeah, and Gonzaga has kind of, they've always been good enough to get to the national championship, but the next big thing is, can they finally break through and win one? Exactly. That's going to be the big question.
Yes.
On the other hand, plenty of teams will be looking to avoid getting upset, as you had mentioned. So which teams do you see getting upset?
I see, if I had to pick an upset, I mean, I see Baylor getting an upset. I see Arizona potentially getting an upset, too. I could see them lose. I said it. I could see them losing to Seton Hall.
It's funny you say that. That could happen. I agree. Seton Hall's a really good team. I could see Arizona making it pretty far. They're going to run into some bumpy roads there with TCU or Seton Hall, 2 very good teams. And then Houston and Illinois, very good teams as well.
I definitely don't see Kansas making it. I don't know. I just don't trust them. And I feel like they could lose to a lot of teams. I wouldn't be surprised if Creighton upset them or if LSU knocked them out if they got to the point. But I don't see Kansas making it far. They haven't really produced that well in these last couple of years, especially just some of the teams that they lost to this year. I don't see them making it that far.
It's funny you mentioned the Midwest bracket. There are a lot of teams out of that I could see making it. Obviously, Kansas is number one seed. I do agree with you. I don't think they have what it takes to get to the Final Four. I know we talked about Iowa being just scoring. You know, they're torching the Nets.
Yeah.
They could make a run. I could see them beating Kansas down the road. And Auburn, of course, another team that people are looking at as the favorite there. I also wouldn't sleep on Wisconsin, though. They've got a very good core there with Brad Davison, who I don't like as a person, but he's very good on the basketball court. And Johnny Davis is one of the better players in the league as well. So there's a lot of teams out of the Midwest that could make it, but plenty of upsets could happen as well.
Yeah, what if you see Auburn get upset by USC?
That could happen.
That'd be upset. That'd be upset of the Midwest right there. If USC were to beat Auburn, I feel like some bad team is going to beat a good team, so I wouldn't be surprised if that's going to happen.
Yeah, I see Virginia Tech beating Texas as well as a possible upset, and a few others as well. I think Indiana could beat St. Mary's. I don't think St. Mary's has a chance there.
No.
So we'll see what happens. Mm-hmm.
Okay, on the other side of this break, we will be breaking down the bracket region by region. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back.
The zone. We'll start off our region by region breakdown of the tournament in the Western bracket, where we find number one overall seed Gonzaga. Xavier, just what are you looking at? What are you thinking when you look at this Western region?
When I look at this Western region, I see it slightly competitive. I mean, I do definitely see Gonzaga having it pretty easy. I feel like their toughest would probably be UConn or Memphis, depending on if they play either both of those. I could see them definitely playing Memphis and then going on to play for them to play UConn, because UConn's gonna beat New Mexico. Besides that, I mean, Texas Tech, you never know. They've done their thing once in a while. But the question is, are we gonna get Duke versus Gonzaga?
I don't think so. Duke has had a lot of struggles toward the end of the season. We saw them get absolutely embarrassed in their Coach K last farewell game at
North Carolina, yes.
And then even in the ACC tournament, they struggled against Syracuse. Syracuse hung around. They struggled against Miami, barely beat them. And then ultimately they lose to
Virginia Tech.
Virginia Tech, yeah. So I think when you look at the possible matchup of them against Michigan State, Tom Izzo, one of the better coaches in all of college basketball, always gets his team ready for March. Mm-hmm. So that's going to be a tough game. Take it a step further, you possibly have Texas Tech against Duke. With all the struggles that Duke has had, sure, they're going to want to send Coach K out the right way. I just don't see it happening.
I see, in my opinion, for the West, I see it going down to potentially Gonzaga versus Alabama or Michigan State.
Yeah, I could see that for sure. Alabama's a team that if they hit their stride at the right time, if they get things to go the right way, they could certainly make a run. But they have been inconsistent at times. Even in the SEC tournament, they lost to Vanderbilt, I believe, and Vanderbilt, not one of the better teams in the country. But Alabama definitely has the talent to make a run.
Got you.
In arguably the easiest region, the Eastern region, where we find Baylor as the number one seed. As we mentioned, Baylor beat Gonzaga in the national championship last year. And despite a less than stellar performance in the Big 12 tournament, they do get that number one seed. Kentucky, Purdue, and UCLA are the other top dogs in the East. So who do you see coming out of the Eastern region?
I see it going down to either Baylor, UCLA, either one of those playing against Kentucky. And I see if Kentucky plays UCLA, I see them making it far. If they beat Baylor, it's a toss-up. Personally, I still, at their best, both teams, I'll give it to Kentucky.
Yeah.
But I wouldn't be surprised, because Baylor has shown that as a team, they're not a individual players type team. They don't have necessarily one star, but they have a good coaching and good playing scheme, where I wouldn't be. Baylor is that team that doesn't surprise me if they win or lose.
Yeah, but I think if Baylor didn't have all the injuries that they have,
yes,
they would be much better, and they would have been getting a lot more respect from the experts and everything.
Yeah, they didn't lose a lot in the draft either, so they still have a lot of those same players from last year too.
Exactly. They just had one star player was injured, and that kind of derailed them a little bit. But I look at this bracket, and as you mentioned, UCLA and Kentucky are the teams that I like, for sure. Baylor, as you said, at their best, they could definitely make a deep run as well.
North Carolina versus Baylor, do you think Baylor's still going to win?
I could see Carolina giving them a good run for the money. Baylor might win, but I could see Carolina pulling that upset off.
Got you. And now looking at the South bracket, how do you see the loaded South region playing out, Michael?
Well, Arizona, as we mentioned, one of the other favorites, I could see them making a deep run. I'm also liking Tennessee, though. I think we look at Tennessee winning the SEC. I think they're a team that a lot of people are sleeping on right now. I look at the bottom of that bracket. Villanova could make a run.
They could.
But with Loyola Chicago down there, you never know what's going to happen with good old Sister Jean.
Sister Jean.
Loyola Chicago seems pretty, you know, famous for making deep runs and, you know, upsetting teams. So that's going to be their main roadblock for Villanova, from Villanova's perspective. But I do like Tennessee and Arizona to be in the Elite Eight game there.
Okay. I see, me personally, I see Arizona losing to Seton Hall. I see it happening. I don't know. Seton Hall is one of those teams that I feel like they can beat anyone at their best. And I don't – Arizona and Kansas are, I feel like, the worst two number one teams out of all the number one teams that I wouldn't be surprised if they don't make it to the finals in the South.
Yeah, I think Arizona, as we mentioned, they could run into some tough teams there. I think if Arizona does lose, if that goes the way you think it will, that opens the door for a team like Houston or Illinois. Mm. Illinois, that's going to be a tough game for them against Chattanooga. Chattanooga's got some really good scores. And in March Madness, when you start hitting some shots, the momentum starts going your way, the crowd sways over your side. So that could be a tough game.
Illinois didn't do too well last March Madness either, but I feel like they had that in their head. I personally think that Villanova's going to go all the way if Arizona were to lose, because I feel like they're just too hot right now.
Yeah.
I can see that. Yeah.
For sure.
Last but not least, the Midwest bracket has a few Final Four contenders as well. Michael, which teams do you think can possibly make it out of the Midwest?
I think it's going to come down to Auburn, Wisconsin, Iowa, or Kansas. Now, that is if Iowa is playing the way that they did to end the season. If not, they probably won't get too far. But at the same time, with Iowa, with Keegan Murray and the McCaffrey brothers, they start hitting those shots, it's game over. And a possible matchup between them and Kansas, that could be a really good game.
How far do you think LSU can go?
I don't see them getting too far, only because of all the issues they're having right now. They got 3 FBI allegations with recruiting, cheating, and stuff like that. They just fired Will Wade, their head coach, former head coach now. I only see them beating Iowa State because Iowa State doesn't score all that much. So I see LSU possibly winning that game, but I don't see them beating Wisconsin in the second round there. But to get back to your point earlier, USC over Auburn, that could happen. USC, I think, at a 7 seed is a little surprising. They could have been a higher seed, but I think they're a very talented team as well. So that Auburn and USC, that could be a very good game as well.
If that happens, in my opinion, that would be upset of March Madness right there.
Yeah, and for USC, they've had trouble beating top teams. They've had trouble beating top 25 teams. This would get them over that hump.
Yes, sir.
So that will do it for this episode of In the Zone. I'm Michael Zebkowski.
And I'm Xavier Johnson. And thank you for watching.